My brothers and sisters in Christ, has anyone here ever said these words, "I don't understand"? I've said it a couple of times. Although I have had conversations with a teenager and as a teenager in which I was convinced I did understand everything, those years have passed. There was a famous 17th century English philosopher, John Locke, who wrote an essay concerning human understanding. And this is what he said. "The comprehension of our understanding comes exceedingly short of the vast extent of things. So we as humans will not, do not, have the ability to understand many things." This Sunday, today, we celebrate the solemnity of the Most Holy Trinity, a faith-filled reality that certainly tests the limits of human understanding. So what can we learn today? We've already visited the subject of philosophy, which was not my best subject in school. So let's look to two other subjects. Who out there likes math? All right, a few people. There's medicine for that. Who out there likes English? Okay, the subject English wins a little bit more. Okay. So here's for you math students. What does 1 plus 1 plus 1 equal? It's the new math. It's the new math. We have a tougher question now. For those calculus students out there, how can 3 equal 1? Is there a formula? How can 3 equal 1? Let's think about that. Because as Catholic Christians, we profess in our faith in God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, three persons in one. How does that happen? Let's move on to English. Could the word hug help us to better understand the Trinity? Hug. Three letters, one word. Now we're getting closer, right? But what does a hug have to do with the Trinity? A Franciscan father, Father Daniel Horan, recommended that we don't think of the Trinity anymore in terms of some complicated, confusing math problem, but rather we might benefit more from considering an ancient approach to envisioning what the Trinity is all about. Let's think about it that way. The Trinity, Father Horan says, is about God's ability to hug us. While this might sound weird, the idea that the Trinity is about God's ability to hug us actually goes back to the second century, to a theologian and saint, Saint Irenaeus, who said that the Son and the Spirit are like the two hands of God. Although Irenaeus never used the word hug, the point of his illustration is to help us understand how God acts to create, sustain, and save all creation. What's particularly interesting about this analogy is that it does lend itself to help us think about God as the divine hugger, the divine hugger. So this is a full participation homily, so everyone get ready. What? That means the choir too. What? While you're in your seats, okay, follow me. While you're in your seats, follow me and we'll get this, right? Lean forward a little bit. Yep, that's the way. Yep. Put your hands out in front of you. Fingers, bring your fingers together. Now, as you bring your arms closer to you, keep bringing them in, keep bringing them in. What does that feel like? A hug. Doesn't that feel good? Doesn't that feel good? This is the imagery that St. Irenaeus thought about when he spoke about the hands. God's one creating, sustaining, and saving act, one cosmic act of the Trinity. Notice, at no point in time do the hands of God ever depart from what it is lovingly and personally bringing into existence. All of creation held in the hands of the Creator and brought back to God Himself. God is not some distant clockmaker who winds us up and says, go to it. God is a deeply engaged, personal Creator, lover, and Redeemer who seeks a relationship through the Most Holy Trinity with each one of us every day. God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit seeks to encircle us in His arms and draw us closer to Him. In our readings today, we heard from the book of Proverbs, where wisdom is seen to be with God and in God before the world was created, and that the love of God has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit so that He may share in the many trials and tribulations of our life, in us, with us, alongside of us. We learn in the gospel that the incarnate Word of God, Jesus Christ, is not the only sign of God's continued close presence in our lives. Jesus tells His disciples about the coming of the Spirit, the Advocate, the one who will be ever present and guide us to, not just anywhere, guide us to the truth. So if in today's gospel this was some kind of strange play, the stage instructions would say, enter the second hand of God, the Holy Trinity. The Holy Spirit is the other assurance of God's eminence throughout creation because the Spirit is God. The Spirit is the one that maintains communion, that is, in continued active presence of God in the world. The Spirit is the second hand of God that reaches out in one single divine act of creation and salvation. It's not a big bang, it's a big hug. Instead of trying to make sense out of some mathematical equation, some physics exercise, some English word, let's think more about what God is like. And when you need God most in your life, wouldn't it be great to say, God, most holy Father, your created Son, and your Holy Spirit, please come to me. Isn't that great? It just makes sense. It's not my idea. It's the Franciscan Father, but it just makes sense to me. The question is, do we acknowledge this? Do we acknowledge that God is a personal God in our lives and that He wants to be so close to us in the person of His Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Can we see this reality? Can we let God hug us? Only when we come to understand what this Trinity is all about, within our human understanding, can we fully embrace this beautiful blessing that St. Paul says in his letter to the Corinthians. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Let us today and every day invite God in the Most Holy Trinity to hug us.